one thing that we may not have seen what's happened in Florida yet, but what we did see and what we have seen in this state in this election is the issues with respect to where polling places, early voting polling places are placed, where they were, and there was litigation ensued over it. The superior, then that goes to a superior court judge. The superior court judge then rules on that, and then that is appealed. Normally, this was in the Appalachian State case. The Court of Appeals judge, the Superior Court judge held it unconstitutional, said they had to put it there. The state appealed to the Court of Appeals. The Court of Appeals refused to issue a stay, so it went forward. So normally in the day-to-day of the mechanism of the election, on the ground during election days, where you will see the courts is whether or not they will uphold what a superior court judge does in those type cases. The only way the Court of Appeals would get involved in that is like at the Appalachian State thing. Someone would have to file a lawsuit in their local superior court, get an order from the superior court before it ever goes to the Court of Appeals. What the superior court does is it rules upon the lawsuit, and then a party who's unhappy with that can appeal that to the Court of Appeals, can ask for a temporary stay of the order if they don't like it, and that's where the appellate courts come in, is in ruling on what the superior courts do. The way that the appellate judge can, and it comes to the appellate process, is if someone is convicted in Superior Court and they have a sentence, they then appeal to the North Carolina Court of Appeals in all cases except where the death penalty is rendered, and those go straight to the Supreme Court. When someone appeals, the view, we look for errors of law as to what, whether the judge did X or Y, but one of the things that people can also raise is, I received ineffective assistance of counsel. And so that's the way that the appellate courts become involved in whether or not someone has a, it's, did you have, a, if someone raises it, I have an ineffective assistance of counsel, the person who was appointed to represent me didn't do X or Y. That's where the appellate court comes in. And I think one way you do that is when you are electing the folks who sit on the trial bench, when you're electing the folks who sit on the appellate bench, you look at the record they have and what they've done and how they've done it and what their life has been. And we can't tell you how we would rule on any case, but you can get some sense of who we are and what we are by what we've done in our life and how we've done it, and the folks who endorse us and the folks who look at our records and tell you what they think of whether or not we will be fair and impartial, and whether or not they think. But it's, you need to be educated about who's on the ballot and look at what they stand for, because if you don't have folks who share your values of non-discrimination and of equal justice for everyone, regardless of their gender, regardless of their race, regardless of their sexual orientation, then you are not going to have confidence in the judiciary around it. I think that there was a move toward privatization of prisons. That has not really taken off much in North Carolina. That is a legislative decision, it's not a judicial decision. There are examples in other jurisdictions, Pennsylvania, for example, that I can remember off the top of my head, where there were judges who were actually tried and convicted because they were in bed with the for-profit prison folks, and so, and turning juveniles so that they, so it's something you need to, again, we've not seen a lot of it in North Carolina. There's been some, but it's not been a lot of, but that's a legislative priority where you need to be dealing with your legislative folks on those things. One other thing that, what the only thing judges have to be able to do that is generally the bully pulpit to come to talk to people like you to say, please talk to your legislator. The other thing that is a travesty, in my opinion, is that your court fees are going up. Your court costs are going up. Your fines are going up. The cost to file a lawsuit is going up. But those funds that are going up, they're not going to the court system, they're going into the general fund, and you need to know about that. So that's another issue that's out there. There are eight registered Republicans, eight registered Democrats, and three registered unaffiliated. And the way that, what happened was there was a retirement on August 1, and under the statute, then the person has to run at the next election for members of the General Assembly because it's more than 60 days. And because there is no primary process, primaries have already happened, it's just a general, and there's no way to really winnow it out. I think the Republicans tried to have a process where the governor told them if they would come up with one person, that he would appoint them. They weren't able to do that. But they then endorsed somebody. What the Democrats didn't do anything to try to, in my opinion, try to talk folks out of it. What they did was they then did an endorsement. Once the Republicans endorsed, they did an endorsement process to try to send a message to folks, is this is the person we think is best able to win. And I'm happy to say I am the endorsed candidate of the Democratic Party. They apparently think I have the best chance to win. There's some other good Democrats in that race, I will tell you that. But there's no mechanism to narrow it in a situation like this. There used to be what was called second. It was an instant runoff. Unfortunately, that didn't work out too well for us either. In the last time, it was because that's Judge Thigpen won the most votes in his first race, but then in the second primary or instant runoff, lost his seat. The General Assembly then did away with that, and we're now back to the situation where we have the situation we had. We've had one other situation like this where Justice Newby is now sitting on the Supreme Court with 23% of the vote, having beaten Justice Wynn